All right, so I had to play this disc twice because I didn't realize that my microphone wasn't working. So this is a freaking ADIAS commercial. Some idiot talking like what he's saying is deep. It's not. And we've seen this before, so let's get right in to the demos. A lot of repeats of older demo discs on here. Get Spider-Man Deuce. Now, I know I played a Spider-Man game in an earlier demo disc. I don't think this is it. I think this might be a sequel. So, let's see what this looks like. I already know, but pretty good character model there. Of course, this is just a loading screen, so you don't have to render an environment, just a character. But I mean, the character in game, I guess, looks like that.
That's my trusty spider compass. It shows me where to go when I'm out and about.
Yay, Spidey compass. I'm not a huge fan of Spider-Man. I had seen the Sam Raimi movies, and that's pretty much my exposure
spider
to it.
Spider sense tingling.
There was a cartoon when I was a kid that I watched a little bit of, but I'm not going to count myself as a fan of Spider-Man. And I'm not a comic book fan either, so I'm not, he's jizzing on the wall. this guy's got a lot of twin brothers, doesn't he? Hey! Oh, he knows how to use those guns. Game doesn't look bad for a PlayStation 1 game, but I mean, we're definitely at an era where people are wanting something that looks better than this. And of course, by this point, both the PlayStation 2 and the Dreamcast are already out. So, no matter how good you make your PlayStation 1 game look, it's gonna kinda look weak sauce compared to what the Dreamcast can do, what the PS2 can do. Yeah, I'm not gonna fight you.
Those guys are up to something.
Those guys are up to something, yeah.
Does this look right to anyone?
Well, why'd you blow up a coffee shop? I mean, they overcharge you for an espresso? The AI for these enemies is amazingly dumb.
How am I gonna put out this fire? I need a lot of water. I could just yank the cap off that hydrant. I could put out the fire.
Yank it then. I don't know how to do that. The demo ended at a strange point for me while I was doing this. Playing this before, though, so I'm not quite sure what I did to end it. Something to do with this car over here. A lot of verticality in these environments here. Something I wouldn't quite have expected in a PlayStation 2 game.
What are they up to now?
Oh my god, you moron.
Boy, I doubt the owner's insured against barbarians. If I use enough webbing, I'll smother the fire.
Alright. Jizz all over it then, Spidey. Nope, wrong button. There you go.
A little paint and Bondo should fix things here. There.
Bondo.
I bet those guys weren't working alone. I'd better patrol the area to be sure.
Oh, do I just gotta beat everybody? Is that what it is?
Time to save the day. Or evening.
Alright, so
time to patrol.
I don't know what I gotta do to get this fire cabinet. Oh, the place blew up. I lost. Oh, well. I guess you gotta do what you gotta do real quick, huh? Pretty sure this is the last PlayStation 1 demo disc that is seen in the official US PlayStation magazine after this. They alternated back and forth for a little bit, but I think after this it is strictly a PlayStation 2 demo disc. And there is really a big difference in terms of production quality and everything between the two. Because PlayStation 2 uses a DVD. I mean, there are CD PlayStation 2 games, but the PlayStation 2 had the capacity to use DVDs. Much more storage. It loads faster. The videos are of a higher quality, and there could be more of them. Overall, just the what they did with the PlayStation 2 demo discs is just night and day better than what they were doing with the PS1 discs. I mean, they had developer interviews, they had more interactivity, the menus looked better, all that kind of stuff. Not to mention the fact that it had PlayStation 2 games instead of PlayStation 1 games. It was just a huge thing. And I've already done a PlayStation 2. Oh my god, the performance is terrible. I mean, I'm sure the actual game worked better than what we're looking at here on actual hardware. I mean, I'm running this on an emulator. Oh my. What Magneto's known for, his ability to kick. Headbutt. Headbutt. I guess if you got that mask on, it's gonna hurt. This is terrible. This is absolutely terrible. Alright, I win. Let's get out of here. That is just dreadful. Barbie Explorer, oh my god. Alright, let's get this over with. Or not. Skipping over that intro. Skip over this intro, too. For what I can only assume... Oh, God. Never mind. Look at that thing. What I can only assume is not a AAA game. This Barbie game actually looks...
Whoa, watch out for the snowballs!
Oh, the snowballs! Damn it, Barbie, jump over shit. Thank you, Barbie.
Jump or dive to avoid the snowball.
Or not, whatever. I don't know. Dive. You can dive. You can roll. Ah, what? Ah. Timing these jumps is a pain in the ass. What am I supposed to do when I get up there? There's no combat in this game. Damn it, Barbie. What are you doing here? You're not Lara Croft.
What a big coward.
Well, it ran away, so take that as a win. This level actually looks worse than the other one did. Oh, is it over? Oh, awesome. All right, let's get out of here. Crash Bandicoot Warp. This is a demo I definitely played in an earlier demo disc. I think this demo could have been better. On one hand, I feel like it would have been a better representation of the game if they had one of the more traditional Crash levels as opposed to this one riding the tiger. But also, this is what, like the third or fourth Crash game? I mean, there were a lot of them for the PlayStation 1. So, at some point, people are going to be like, well, no matter how good the game is, people have seen the basic gameplay loop of Crash Bandicoot before. And you're trying to sell to the same audience that had bought the other ones, really. So, throw in one of the different kind of levels, you know? See if that spikes anyone's interest. The first Crash, at least, was a pretty strong example of what PlayStation 1 games could look like in terms of graphic quality, and fairly early in the PlayStation 1's life cycle, too. By this point, this game definitely looks better than the original Crash does. Draw distances further out, the models look a little bit more detailed, all that kind of stuff. But by this point, other developers had really learned to sort of grasp the PlayStation 1 hardware as well. So by comparison, it's not as big of a leap over what everyone else was doing. I mean, look back at the first episode of this series, Demo Disc Theater Episode 1. I did the demo for the original Crash Bandicoot. At least I think that was the first episode. And see what that game looked like. And then compare it. Oh, actually, you know what? No, never mind. I got it wrong. It wasn't the first episode. I eventually hit it, though. It wasn't the first episode. It was actually a little ways. You know what? I don't know. It's kind of stupid of me to bring this up if I don't remember. But the original Crash Bandicoot, I played an episode of Demo Disc Theater, and it looked pretty much night and day better than every other game on that disc. Late in the generation, Crash looks better, but all the other games look better too. I mean, hell, even that Barbie game didn't look like absolute trash. Oh shit, I dropped my controller and the batteries fell out. There we go. Tekken 3. Okay, Tekken 3. The last Tekken game that came out for the PlayStation 1. It was probably, in my opinion anyway, the best fighting game that came out for the PlayStation 1. They had, a lot of people think that Soul Edge, is that what it was called? Soul Edge? The first Soul Calibur game. A lot of people say that was the best fighting game on the PlayStation 1. I don't necessarily agree with that, but you know, whatever. But, this demo was actually quite a few years old. Tekken 3 had come out years before. And although it doesn't look bad as a PlayStation 1 game, it definitely doesn't look incredible compared to other PlayStation 1 games of the era that this demo disc was made. Of course, it looked freaking incredible at the time of release. But, you know, where PlayStation 1 was definitely a generation where you saw enormous improvement in terms of graphical performance and everything like that over the generation. So the couple of years between when this demo was made and when we're looking at now, it's like a lifetime. All right, so let's get out of here. I think Tekken Tag Tournament, which was a PlayStation 2 game, maybe a launch title, was the next Tekken game. Of course, Tekken was an arcade game, but it was built on an arcade platform board that was actually, like, based on the PlayStation hardware. So, porting these games to the PlayStation was relatively straightforward. I think there was less memory on the PlayStation, and it was running off of an optical disc, a CD, instead of the arcade board, which is probably like a series of ROM chips. What did I jump into? What is this? Oh, Spyro. All right, so it definitely played Spyro, Year of the Dragon, in an earlier demo disc. These are probably here because they are PlayStation classics, the re-released titles for budgets. Oh, you swimming.
While I was gone, my friends borrowed the rhinox.
Oh, God. I don't need to hear you talking, weird little creature. PlayStation Classics Collection were budget-released PlayStation games. They cost, like, $20 instead of, like, the $40 or $50 that the PlayStation 1 games usually were at. Probably because Sony went and dropped, like, the licensing fees for PlayStation 1. I know Sony did actually at some point go and drop the licensing fees to release PlayStation 1 games, so you start to see a lot of brand new games coming out for $10, which was mind-blowing. I mean, most of them weren't particularly good titles, like Spec Ops and whatever, but I guess it was probably about the era that the PlayStation 2 released, and Sony's like, well, if we're making money on PlayStation 1 hardware being sold, so, you know, why not go and drop the licensing fees so the PlayStation 1 continues to sell, so PlayStation 1 games can be very inexpensive. And it entices developers to keep developing for it, but, I mean, you know, anybody who's serious about it's definitely going to be on the PlayStation 2, not the PS1. They never did that again, though, so it must not have worked out for them. Now, this is a third-party game, Spyro, developed by Insomniac. Insomniac is now a PlayStation first-party studio, but everything that they did for so long was so closely associated with PlayStation that I kind of always assumed that Sony owned them. I mean, I don't remember Insomniac games coming out for the N64 or the Saturn. I don't remember Insomniac games coming out for the 360. But there was that Xbox One game, what was it, Sunset Overdrive, I think it was called. That was a Xbox One exclusive. I think there's a PC, is there a PC release for that game? I don't know. You'd think there would be, considering it was done in a publishing deal with Microsoft. Microsoft loves their PC releases. Or at least they do now, maybe they didn't at the time. But Spyro ended up being...
My plan worked! That dumb...
Yeah. Spyro was published, I think, by Universal. So, Insomniac never owned Spyro. But it also... So Spyro, like in some, Spyro ended up being an enormous, enormous profit generator for Universal. Not necessarily because of Spyro itself. I mean, the Spyro games were pretty successful, but Spyro became the basis for Skylanders, that freaking series, which I think it's a dead series now. But it, what is that type of thing called? Gaming toys or toys to life or something like that, where you have this physical component to a video game, which was the Skylanders figures that you'd use to import in game. I never played Skylanders, but I'd seen them everywhere. That made billions of dollars for Universal. I mean, an insane amount of money. I think it was a fad that's over with now, but for a long time, a few years anyway, Skylanders made an insane amount of money, and Spyro the Dragon was the sort of basis of what that was originally based around. So it's grown, it grew beyond Spyro at some point, but just keep in mind that Spyro started one of the most... Okay, I've looped back to where I started. Spyro is at the core of that, for better or for worse. Okay, so I gotta go through the portal. Is it over? Yes, it is. Syphon Filter 2, another classics. Syphon Filter 2, the only Syphon Filter game in which I had beaten. I didn't even own the original Syphon Filter until it was released on the PlayStation 3 as a PlayStation 1 Classics release. Syphon Filter 2, back when it was a fairly new game, somebody lent it to me. And I spent a good couple of weeks with it. It was frustrating. It was a frustrating as hell game. Because not just the control... Ah, shit. I jumped out of it. All right, go back in. It was a frustrating game because... Not just because the controls are archaic and all of that. But because a lot... If I remember this correctly, it's been more than 20 years since I played it. Since I beat it, anyway. I played the demo on an earlier episode. 989 Studios. The enemy AI can, for some reason, in certain encounters, just sort of lock on a headshot from, like, the other side of the environment. Like, I remember this one guy you're supposed to be following. You okay? It's about time you checked in. And he ended up not even being the guy you were after, I think. Voice acting is terrible. But anyway, like, there was a guy that you gotta follow, and he's... Every once in a while, he'd turn around and just blind fire some, there we go. He'd blind fire a shot in your direction. What are you doing? I forget how to jump. There we go. Oh, God, this is terrible. Fire him up! And sometimes that blind fire shot that he would just hit you with would hit, just headshot you. This game is a challenge. I'm sure if I spent enough time with this, I would, if I spent enough time with this, I'm sure I would have it down. But, you know, I'm not gonna. Fire him up!
Ha.
I remember the ending involved a guy in a, like, oh shit. A guy wearing body armor who you couldn't actually hurt because the body armor was so good that you ended up, like, even if you hit him with a grenade round or something like that, it would just knock him backwards. And the way you killed him was by taking a semi-auto shotgun, like a Spaz 12, and shooting him in the chest to knock him backwards. And you do that until you knocked him into helicopter blades. That was how you killed the end boss. Man, I gotta collect ammo after every encounter. Your aim sucks, Gabe. I'm out of ammo. Fuck. Alright, that's enough of this. But it took me a while to beat it. Also, with my friend, there was a two-player, like, deathmatch kind of thing that we played a lot. That was cool. Although it probably wasn't any good. Twisted Metal 2, is this a demo? I don't remember playing a demo for Twisted Metal 2. Metal 2 just didn't load. So unfortunately, I won't get to play that one, which is a shame. I was looking forward to playing some Twisted Metal 2. I think I could be wrong. I'll have to look this up later. But I think the first two Twisted Metal games were developed by a different studio than what developed, like, 3 and onwards. I know 3 and 4 and whatever were done by 989. And I think Twisted Metal 1 and 2 were done by Singletrack. Now, it's possible that they were actually the same studio, just with a different name. But I think the early Twisted Metal games were David Jaffe games. And if it was Singletrack did a lot of early PlayStation 1 stuff that was really kind of iconic. There was Twisted Metal, of course, and there was Jet Moto and Warhawk. All those were great games, and I think they were all done by the same studio. ADIAS ad. Dragon Warrior 7. Dragon Warrior series? Not something... This it's a video.
This game has not yet been rated.
Not something I ever got into. And that feels like a bit of a shame, because I know people, like, they're, like, highly praised. And Enix and Square Enix... Square and Enix are the same company now, so it's sort of under the same house as the Final Fantasy series. I know there's a Dragon Warrior game made not that long ago that I keep seeing advertisements for on Steam, so maybe I should look into that. Okay, this does not look like a AAA release. Not to judge a book by its cover, although that's exactly what I'm doing now. They're using the 2D characters on 3D environment technique, which I'm actually quite fond of. Like, Xenogears and the Breath of Fire series did the same thing. Problem is, the character sprites, they're not making the best of them. I'm not a huge fan of these overly chibi model things, but there's not much animation to them. So the game looks ugly. I mean, it might be a good game, though. I'm just being a curmudgeon. And I feel like this is one of those ones that they did a remake of. Syphon Filter 3. Oh, no. That's a video. You know, I don't know if I ever played Syphon Filter 3. I know the Syphon Filter games, there were Syphon Filter games for PlayStation 2 or 3, and I know the series continued past the PlayStation 1, although I'm not sure how far, how long it continued. I mean, it was kind of this action third-person shooter genre. The PlayStation 1 was really not the best console to release something like that. And not just because of the normal technical limitations you're talking about, like texture resolution and polygon pushing power, but the controller is really the issue. As much as you would like to produce one with a better control style, the fact is you couldn't assume that everybody that owned a PlayStation 1 had the dual analog controller or the DualShock controllers, which would have facilitated a better control experience. You had to assume that most people were going to be stuck with the D-pad controller, the digital controller. And that's not really that conducive to making a good control scheme for a third-person shooter. Camera control and all of that, modern days anyway, anyone from like the PlayStation 3, or really even PlayStation 2 era, forward in some games at least. You map movement to the left stick and camera control to the right stick, and then you fire using the shoulder buttons, the trigger buttons. They didn't really figure that out for a while, and they couldn't really do it at all if you didn't have the analog sticks. Spider-Man 2, oh wait, alright, we've looped back around. So that is official US PlayStation Magazine demo disc number 50 for the PlayStation 1, I believe the last one for the PlayStation 1. End of an era. Let me try Twisted Metal 2 again, just to see if it will load. I don't think it will.